Welcome to MCN, welcome to South Africa, welcome to the launch of the bike behind me, which is the new Husqvarna 901 Norden Expedition. So before we get into the bike, we've had two amazing days of riding in South Africa here. Real mix of terrain, from fast unmade roads to some billiard smooth tarmac, through to the other end, some real technical riding. Loose, rocky, sand, all the sort of stuff that generally adventure bikes don't always perform that well in. Before we get into that, I just want to kind of see how I think that this bike fits into the market. So we're at a time now where adventure bikes, the big adventure bikes, you know, the GSs, the KTM 1290s, the Ducati Multistrada V4, they're just getting bigger and bigger, more and more sophisticated, more and more rider aids, and heavier ultimately less capable when it comes to genuine off-road and adventure type riding. Obviously the market has changed. We've now got very much different categories in terms of, we've got the sort of middleweight class, for want of a better word, the Yamaha Tenere 700 and now the World Raid. We've got the Aprilia Touareg, came out last year. And you've obviously got bikes that have been around for a while, the KTM 790 turned into the 890, and in fact, the first generation of the Norden, the standard Norden, if you like, which came out last year. So the idea of the Expedition is that it's sort of taking on the best bits from all these categories and trying to make something new, trying to make something better. So the question really is how have they done it, and ultimately have they actually managed to succeed in building an adventure bike which maybe ticks even more boxes than the current bikes out there, in terms of being, have even more all-round appeal for an actual adventure bike. First of all, I think it looks great. The first time I saw it, I thought that the styling of it, you know, you've got the round headlights, quite a retro kind of look, but the original version, you know, it was grey and yellow, and I don't know, it didn't really do it for me. It didn't look that exciting. It didn't look like something I particularly want to ride. It just looked like a sort of a bit of a soft option. I don't think that does. I mean, it looks good from a distance, but if you get up close to it, the way the graphics, the styling, I think they've done a really nice job of it, of not being too over the top. You know, it's not like an 890, which is blazing in orange. You know, it's a bit more subtle. The sort of topography lines on the paintwork, you know, trying to sort of give a bit of an insight into its intentions, ultimately, for sort of worldwide global travel. So at the heart of it is the LC8 engine, which, for anyone that doesn't know, KTM own Husqvarna. So it is a, you know, they've used this platform in different bikes, i.e. the KTM 890 and 890R. But the LC8 engine is a bit of a peach, to be perfectly honest. You know, they've been working on this engine for a long, long time, and through ever improving electronics, which have come to the market, not just at KTM, but, you know, across the whole market, across the whole of motorcycling, they've really been able to sort of refine it and deliver a great, great package. I mean, I personally, I've had a KTM 890R and a 790R, and I really like the engine. I really like the sort of fun factor. I like the sort of urgency of it when you're riding it. It doesn't necessarily sound that amazing, especially on startup. It sounds a bit rattly, to be perfectly honest, but as soon as the oil starts circulating, it sounds pretty normal. And then when you're actually on the gas, even with the standard exhaust, it sounds good. You know, it sounds like, sounds meaningful. You know, it sounds like it's it's a fun side of motorcycling. You know, it's saying this is a performance I've got, you are welcome to it, go and enjoy it. So it's 105 horsepower, which is a pretty respectable figure for this size of bike and this category of bike. But the way it's geared and the way it's fueled, like I say, there is a real kind of urgency with it. The engine itself is compact, it's neat, it's only 54 kilograms, the actual engine itself, and it forms, it's a stressed member of the chassis, so it's a steel chassis. So that's enabled them to make the proportions quite small and enabled them to keep the weight down and keep the position of the engine low and improve center of gravity. And on the subject of center of gravity, just going back to the exhaust and the exhaust note, unlike a lot of bikes now, we're seeing ever bigger end cans on these bikes. You know, it's a comment we see a lot about on videos, you know, people just saying, look at the size of the end can kind of thing. But on this bike, the actual catalytic converter, sorry, the reason why they're all so big is because the catalytic converter's in them for emissions. But on the Husqvarna, the catalytic converter is actually in the mid pipe. So it's tucked away, it's low, it's behind the swinging arm, and which is in it's a heavy component. So again, that is helping reduce that center of gravity, lower that center of gravity. And it also means that the exhaust, the actual silencer, can be significantly smaller. It's quite neat. You can't really see it because it's covered by the panniers, which I'll come to shortly. But it's obviously going to be lighter because it doesn't have all the cat details in it. That's something that's physically higher up on the bike. So just improving that center of gravity is another thing that obviously is just what you need if you're riding off road or any sort of road. You know, you notice it when you're moving the bike around. The other thing that helps the center of gravity is the low fuel tanks. So instead of the fuel tank sitting in front of you, it's sitting down on the by your knees basically, or under your knees at the front of the bike. You can see the bash plate covering it there. This bike's got a 4mm aluminium bash plate which covers all those fuel tanks to give it extra protection. But that means that the fuel is sitting low, and because it sits low, that also improves the center of gravity. And the other thing that I really like about that, which is a knock-on effect, is the fact that when you're sat on the bike, you don't have a tank sitting up in front of you. You don't have that traditional tank there right in front of you, which is obviously, you know, if you're putting 20 litres of fuel in the bike, that's, you know, for argument's sake, 20 kilograms of weight sat right on top of the bike. Obviously the fuel's much lower, but it has the added benefit of just, you've got a lot of space in front of you. It's quite flat from the seat, the front of the seat, to the headstock essentially. So it just enables you to be able to move around on the bike. It's a really comfortable distance, I find, between where you're sat and the actual handlebars. So it means that it's no issue kind of shuffling back on the seat. If you move to the back of the seat, someone my size, you know, sort of 5'9", you don't feel like you're suddenly at a real stretch with the bars. And conversely, if you want to get weight over the front when you're sat down on the bike, you can kind of shuffle your way forward, and you can, it's quite narrow right at the front of the seat. So I dropped the bike actually in some soft sand, and luckily it was caught on video. So I was, you know, you're there, and you know the adrenaline's going, you've just crashed, it was nothing serious, but you still got to pick the thing up. And I actually didn't find it too difficult to pick up, and I'm not the sort of strongest guy in the world. So look, it's a big bike, it's 205 kilos. So, you know, that weight is there, but because it is quite low in the bike, it also helps because the tanks are wide for the bike, a bit like a GS, they never really sort of fully fall over because they end up, a GS obviously ends up on its engine cases. This kind of ends up on its fuel tanks, but both of which are well protected. So it just means that you're not sort of starting from completely horizontal. You've got a few degrees there, which is, you know, it's generally the hardest bit when you're trying to hoik a bike up to get going. The engine has a double balancer shaft just to make it smooth and torquey, and so it's pretty much essentially vibe free for a parallel twin. Also, service intervals are 15,000 kilometres, so, you know, just under 10,000 kilometres between services, which is obviously a decent amount. So coming to the chassis, like most hardcore adventure bikes or sort of genuine adventure bikes. It's got a 21 inch front wheel up front, 21 90 90, and it's got an 18 inch rear. So they're both tubeless, spoked tubeless, spoked obviously just much stronger wheel, much less likely to crack. If you have a problem, it's one spoke rather than if you have a cast wheel, it could crack completely. And being tubeless, you know, in theory, you can repair, you know, you can plug a tube tire should you be out on the trails. So suspension is also a real area that Husqvarna takes seriously. Like I said, the brand KTM own WP suspension, and they also obviously own Husqvarna, so there's a tie-in with all their bikes. But WP suspension is very good, you know, it's top-notch kit. And one big difference over the old Norden, had 43mm Apex forks. This has got 48mm Explore forks, which are, so they're physically bigger, so they're more rigid, it gives more stability, but also the internals, it's a higher spec internal, so you've got double piston in there, you've got technology to stop them completely bottoming out, and the sensation is good. You know, we did quite a lot of riding today where we were climbing, we needed momentum, we needed speed, and we were just going over sort of random rocks, but you know, sort of, you know, fist size rocks, stuff that's just, you know, prime for sending your wheels in all directions, sending your front wheel in all directions. And it's impressive how a bike of that size could get up these sort of climbs. I honestly think it's some of the hardest riding I have done on an adventure bike. I've done harder stuff on an enduro bike or a KTM 690, that sort of, you know, kind of lighter weight adventure, big enduro bike, whatever you want to call it. But an actual adventure bike, I've probably done bits that have been hard for 20-30 meters, but this particular one, we were probably climbing for like 3 or 4 kilometers, not all up and all rocky, but we were kind of progressing all the way up, and it was, you know, we had like sort of 200 meter stretches of loose rock, you know, and stopping really wasn't an option. You just had to keep momentum, keep ploughing on. And very impressive. At the rear, you've got a PDS shock, which is a progressive damping system, so no linkage. That's attached to a aluminium swing arm. What they've done is they've actually extended the length of the swing arm, so the actual chassis is a little bit shorter, and that improves grip and it improves stability. So on that note of grip, I think it's quite important to say that, you know, I touched on it already, the fact that all these bikes are getting more and more advanced electronics, and the electronics you're seeing on bikes are good. Most of them are using a Bosch system, which is kind of like the go-to for all these manufacturers. How they program it is obviously down to each individual manufacturer, but the way this, I think it should be noted, the mechanical grip this bike generates. It's surprising how you'll be on terrain and you're driving and you're kind of expecting more electronic intervention than it's actually having to do, because it's actually generating the grip. And I think that's largely down to the quality of the suspension. Another thing as well is that I did play around with the clickers on the suspension, and sometimes you have suspension, you know, you do 5-6 clicks or turns of rebound, and sort of, has that made a difference? Has it not made a difference? With this, you know, a couple of clicks and you're thinking, yeah, that does feel better, that does feel more stable, that does feel just more secure, more feedback. So that's generally a sign of kind of quality suspension, to be honest, the fact that you can make small changes and they do actually do something. So in terms of ground clearance as well, you've got more suspension travel on the bike now, so this is now up to 240mm, whereas the original Norden, or the standard Norden if you like, is a 220 front and 215 rear. So you've gained a chunk of suspension. We were riding quite hard at times. I bottomed it out once. I think I bottomed it out. I don't know whether it was that or the centre stand hitting the ground, but I only had one moment, which I think, given the riding we were doing, given that we had a bit of luggage on board, I think he's pretty good, to be perfectly honest. I think it's quite an impressive geometry and suspension setup, which is delivering good grip and really controllable power. But even though you've got a lot of power on tap, you can get it down to the ground, which is key. Look, it has been dry here, loose but dry, you know. We're running the STR tyres, Pirelli STRs, which are very good on the road. You know, they really do perform well on the road, and they're standard fit in the UK on the Tenere and the Touareg. So they're well, you know, they're very much a proven tyre for this sort of class of bike. I wouldn't want to ride in mud with them in the UK. I think they'd get packed in too quick and you'd struggle for grip. But on the terrain we've been on, there's been no danger of that. Even the terrain's been loose, there's been no danger of the tyre actually sort of packing up with mud. So I've been impressed, you know, how, like I say, the places we've been able to take it to and the way it's gone about it has been impressive. So on the electronics, like I mentioned, it's a Bosch ECU and there's a lot of options to choose from. So the standard ride mode, you've got street, you've got off-road and you've got rain, and then you've got an explorer mode. So in addition to those modes, you've also got throttle response. So you can dial in whether you want the rally response, which basically gives you everything the engine's got at all times. And then you've also got an off-road throttle response and a street throttle response, which are basically just tailored version of those, but essentially less power, less urgency. You can play around with the ABS, so you've got the ABS can be on, and then you've also got an off-road setting, and that enables the rear to lock. Front you can't turn off, but if you have it in the off-road ABS, it basically allows a lot more slip. Because what can potentially happen if you've got too intrusive ABS, and if you're going downhill and it's loose and slippery, you kind of, the wheel is just keeps on trying to sort of free itself because it feels it locking and then frees it, which is quite an unnerving feeling. One finger on the brake, no problem at all, all day, especially off-road where you need that sort of finesse. I think a little bit wooden when you're really sort of squeezing them, but for the sort of lighter use, I felt I had quite a lot of feel. Rear brake is nice, not too, quite gentle as well. It's quite easy to lock the rear up when you're wearing big motocross boots or off-road boots. So felt quite nice, that whole sort of setup. All of that is displayed with a 5-inch TFT dash, which is clear, pretty intuitive, got a lot of information on there. You just need to scroll through it. You've also got a GPS mount just on top, which is quite a nice touch, a simple thing, but it's ultimately what that bike is aimed at, people going to actually explore and use the thing off-road. So I guess the question is sort of what stands this out from the standard Norden, what makes it the Expedition? And the real kind of key thing for me is one of them is the screen. So the screen is significantly bigger than something like a Tenere or a Touareg or a 890. It's quite high, and right at the end of it, the top of it rather, it's vertical. So you find that, I was quite worried that it would really be in my line of sight, but it's not, and it really hasn't been a problem at all. Look, we haven't ridden on motorways here, but we have done motorway speeds on some big kind of A-road equivalents, if you like, you know, not for hours on end. So I can only give a certain opinion on this so far. But I've been wearing a Arai Tour X4 helmet with the peak on the top, and there is wind noise, but there's not an unpleasant buffeting, which is a problem certainly the old 890 had. It was quite sort of the resonance of the vibration around your head just did kind of drive you a bit crazy. So this feels good in terms of, it just feels like the air is, it's not hitting you in the face. It certainly wasn't getting under the peak, which would sort of suggest you can hear it. You know, I haven't been wearing earplugs either, but it feels like it's sort of essentially touching the top of your helmet rather than, you know, hitting around the sides and causing that sort of unpleasant turbulence. Another reason for that is there's actually a hole in the screen halfway up or a third up rather, and that the idea of that is just to relieve that sort of pressure that can build up with the aero of the air going over the top. And in terms of the resonance and the buffeting side of things, it seems to be working. I would like to kind of crush out a couple of hours on the motorway and see how it worked, but I think they have nailed it. See, the other things about the Expedition model, you've got the, I've touched on it, the 4mm thick aluminium bash plate, which is quite a substantial bash plate. You know, it's a proper thing. You know, it's not a token thing. It's 4mm, it's beautifully welded, it's strong, it looks the part, kind of looks the part. It's quite big, it looks quite sort of, you know, it's very much part of the look of the bike, but it's a proper thing and it's going to do a good job. The other side of it is you've got heated grips standard, and you've also got heated seat standard, driver seat, not the pillion seat, rider seat, heated seat. So that's standard. You've also got the centre stand, which is obviously great if you are, you know, travelling, you know, further corners of the world and you need to do maintenance of the bike, you know, from the simple things like oiling the chain, especially if you're riding solo, you know, oiling a chain with a side stand on your own is, it's doable, but it's not the easiest thing to do. Centre stand, obviously, just, you know, it just makes things easier. Should you have a puncture, you've got half a chance of being able to, just easier, you know, find the puncture, whatever. And if the worst comes to worst, you've got to start taking wheels out, it's obviously going to be that much easier. The other thing this bike comes with is the panniers. So there's a rack on there. Those panniers aren't aftermarket, they come with the bike. So I think the verdict is out for me on those panniers. I think I kind of like the idea. I kind of like the fact that, you know, they're 18 litres each side. So, you know, decent amount of carrying capacity. I like the fact that they're on the bike, they're there, you know, you go with them. But I don't think they're the finished article, to be perfectly honest. They move around quite a bit. And we've actually had a few of them actually splitting on the seams of the actual pannier themselves. In terms of stuff I don't like about the bike, the width of the seat as you stood up, I think just sort of compromises your riding position a little bit if you're trying to get your weight back. But then that sort of flip side of that is that it's more comfortable. I did have it being quite a bit nervous on the sort of fast off-road trails. And when I'm talking about trails, I'm talking about actual roads, because that is out here in South Africa, the roads are unmade. A lot of them are actually unmade and they're generally in quite good condition, but you do get some potholes. I had a few sort of shaking his head, but I spoke to the WP guys here and literally just added a little bit of compression damping and a little bit less, but some rebound damping, and it did make a difference and make it that much more stable. So kind of was able to dial that out reasonably easily. Off-road, like I've said already, it tracked well, soaked up a lot of abuse, but it does drop quite a long way. There's quite a lot of travel there, so it does, you know, run quite deep into the stroke of the forks, especially. Not so much the shock, I didn't find. Found the shock generally pretty good. The menu system on the bike, there's loads of information there. It's reasonably easy to access, but it does take quite a few presses of the button. You know, I mean, it's sort of like first world problems, but it's kind of, you know, it's like a menu into a menu into a menu for each different sort of sub-menu, if you like. So that, I think, it feels a little bit dated in terms of what the competition is like. Right, so in summary, Husqvarna have taken parts of the 890 in terms of the fork and the spec of that and improved the off-road capabilities of it. They've made it a more focused bike off-road. They've made it more engaging. They've made it more capable. But on the flip side, they've taken some of the weak points of adventure bikes in things like the aerodynamics of the bike. They've improved that side of things. They've also made it more comfortable. They've given it good protection. They've put the panniers on the bike. They've put the heated grips as standard, the heated seat as standard, and really kind of tried to give you the buyer something that can genuinely go out and tackle, be engaging on the road, be able to eat up fire roads all day long, you know, no problem at all, yet still be able to do the sort of harder off-road type of riding, you know, that sort of more extreme riding, which, you know, really do test the credentials of a bike, and there's not that many bikes that sort of fit into that category. You know, things like your Tenere and your Touareg are more capable of it. Your bigger bikes obviously struggle just from a weight point of view. So they're priced at $13,599. It's a lot of bike for the money. I think it fits reasonably well if you compare it against something like the Africa Twin, Ducati Desert X, and then the Tenere's and the Touareg's, obviously a fair bit cheaper, but you are getting quite a lot more with this in terms of the spec of the bike. You know, look, Husqvarna aren't playing at this. They want to bring something new to market. They want to bring something that is going to enable you to do travel, enable you to do real world adventures. And I think they've done a very, very good job. So I've enjoyed the ride. I've enjoyed the experience. And I think that if adventure is your thing, true adventure, where you're carrying your own kit, it's a very, very good option.